Hello everyone, this is Chrisom and I'd like to welcome you to this conversation about your Kundalini Awakening experiences. And this is the other broadcast that I promised you. Sorry, it's a little bit late. But I have some questions that people have asked me from the group, and I'd like to address those questions. And one of the first questions is, will we survive death? No. Your body will not survive death. Your body will not survive death. Your body will go back into its original composition, which is the minerals and basically the minerals of this world. You will become part of the dirt. Even if you're put into the ocean, your ashes will mix and it will settle into the bottom of the ocean. Part of the mud. So no, we will not survive death. However, our consciousness will. Our consciousness will survive death. But not some aspects of our consciousness. So our consciousness, if you follow the Huna teachings, our consciousness is composed of three layers, the Unahipidi, the Uhane, and the Amakua. This kind of relates to the high selves and the ego self. Aspects of the ego self will survive. Okay, the higher self, of course, is always going to survive. The higher self is the one that's going to review the life to see how well the life was lived, or you know, what challenges were there and how were those challenges approached, that type of a scenario. So aspects of ourselves will survive death, and always have, and always will. Okay. You will be you in death. You will be who you are. You just won't be so fixated on the body, feeding the body, or cleaning the body, or doing some of the essentials that you do every day with the body, going to the bathroom, for instance. But you will be fixated on how you treated the body, what you did for the body and with the body, and were you anorexic? Did you fall into anorexia, or did you fall into becoming incredibly obese? How did you treat the body? This will be studied. Why did you do this? Was, you know, what psychological and emotional factors weighed in on becoming anorexic or bulimic or obese? What happened there, and how can that be corrected? Was it, you know, was this a karmic event? What kind of karma did you develop by treating the body in such ways? Okay, so lots of things will go into how you treated the body and why you treated it the way you did. In addition to, of course, all the other things that the karma deals with, like how you treated other people, how you treated the environment, how you treated animals, these types of things. And if you have Kundalini, how did you treat the Kundalini? How did you respect it? How did you disrespect it? Were you resistant? Were you not? That type of a thing. So be aware of this as well. So in order to factor in all of these different angles of karma, you have to have a consciousness that is interested and that is there, that is remembering how you treated Aunt Jane at the last family reunion. Good, bad, whatever it was, right? You've got to have those memories. And you will. You will have those memories of how you treated that person. So, yes, you will survive death, but your physical body will not and should not. Now, with Kundalini, however, with the Kundalini, you will have divine, super, words are coming to me that I'm not sure they're the right words, like superimposition. You'll have like a divine superimposed upon the bones, upon the minerals, upon the hair. That divine signature upon your body will cause it to continue to give radiance even after death. Okay. Your body will still have divine radiance after death, and this is a fact. You just can't get away from that. Now, for me, since I was so recently allowed to believe that I was going to die a couple of weeks ago, I was thinking about, well, what am I going to do with my body? You know, I've got all of this kundalini in my body. What am I going to do with that body? And I figured that I wanted to dig a hole, you know, maybe 10 feet deep, and place my body in it standing up to take up less space, you know, and to plant a fruit tree over the body and to have that as my continuous blessing upon this world. So I was thinking of pomegranate or an apple tree or an orange tree or something of that nature. That's just me. Now, you can kind of factor in how you want to do it, but I know that my radiance would be carried into the fruit of that tree. And those who partook of that fruit would also partake of that radiance. And in some way, I want the body to continue serving incarnate life forms after my death of the incarnate life form. And so, yes, we will survive death. Yes. And no, we won't. Spiritually, energetically, yes. Physically, no. And yet, yes, because we have kundalini. Our radiance still comes through. So there's that question. I hope that made it completely confusing for you. Kidding. It's like clear as mud. We'll see. Another question here. What is the origin of the fat Buddha, the fat happy Buddha? Well, that's a fairly easy one to answer. The origin of the happy Buddha or the fat Buddha is the fact that they meditate so much that they're not getting exercise. And because they're not getting exercise, they're growing that belly. And that is the basics of it. You know, the more you meditate every day, all you're doing is meditating. You take a break here and there, you know, and then you go back and do a sitting meditation. This is kind of like overdoing the meditation. But in reality, you know, you meditate, then you get out and say you work the garden, you chop the wood, you haul the water, you make the tea, you prepare the food, you do service for other people. You know, the life is more than just meditating. But if you spend most of your time meditating and depend on others to give you food and sustenance, as some do, say, like in the Buddhist world, then you become, you grow that belly, and that belly will become pronounced, and from there you can become that fat Buddha. Okay? And it also has to do with the second chakra, second and third chakras focusing more on the sensate body, on the sensation of life, the pleasures of life, the sensual nature of life, and allowing yourself to maybe go a little too far into those areas, becoming attached to the taste of food. You know, taste of food comes only second behind the sexual proclivities. And so, you know, people can become overly obsessed with food and the consuming of food and the tasting of food and the rearranging of different recipes and adding this spice and adding that spice and, you know, being a top chef on TV or whatever. That can also produce a Buddha belly. Definitely. Definitely. So you want to be aware of that. I don't promote a Buddha belly. I don't promote that. I promote more of a balance with that. Yeah, as you may have noticed in some of my other videos and some of the teachings that I put on Kundalini Awakening! And you're most welcome, Julia. I promote the consumption of food that isn't super sugary, that isn't super involved with spices or spicing it up or hot spices, sweet spices, this spice, that spice. I tend to not eat a lot of spices. The only spice that I'll eat really is a black pepper, ground, you know, your regular black pepper that you have that's grown in India and a few other places, and that's it. I believe, yeah, that's about it. I don't use a lot of salt. I don't, you know, my food's pretty bland. And for some people that have the Kundalini, I'm going to suggest that you want to have bland food. You do not want to super excite the adrenals or the bile or any of that stuff. You want to keep a fairly simple, minimally processed diet. Minimally processed means you can cook it, but if you don't have to cook it, don't. Keep as much prana in the food as you can. You got to remember that I grew up in California, in the Great Valley of California, which is this huge farming area in California, and I saw what was sprayed on the crops, and I saw and knew and why it was being sprayed, and the suits that the county made you wear as the crops were being sprayed with these like hazmat suits. That gives you an idea. You want to eat organic, folks. You want to eat organic. Eat organic as much as you can and as best as you can. I mean, it is not worth it. And don't be fooled by the lower prices for the commercial foods, the inorganic foods, which are sprayed with everything that you can talk about, and I'm getting another request for a question about coworkers and work, and I will address that. And hello, Johnny Schwed, good to see you, my friend. Johnny Schwed's in Italy. Anyway, so try to eat as bland a diet as you can. And I'm sorry if this is repeating, but maybe it bears repeating for people. Eat as bland as you can and as healthily as you can, and don't be afraid to follow the Kundalini if she has you eat vegetables and fruits, and only vegetables or fruits. And then the next month she turns around and has you only eat meat.
Call from 5-0-3-8-2-8-0-3-6-9.
The phone machine. So yeah, my apologies for that interruption, of course. So yeah, don't be afraid to eat the meat or the fruits and vegetables, nuts and root vegetables. This is all good. And so we'll go. Robocall. Okay. Okay. I just want to reach over there and shut it off, but I'll just wait for that to stop. There we go. Okay, so keep the food as bland as you can, especially if you're having problems with the Kundalini, like you're not able to sleep or you're really burning up strong. Make sure you put watermelon into that diet. Try to have watermelon every day. Watermelon is God's gift to Kundalini people. I just wish it was a year-round thing. Coconuts are too. So there we have it. Now I'm going to answer a post about being sabotaged by coworkers. And this really goes to the point of having Kundalini and engaging in the work environment. Not the easiest thing all the time. My Kundalini would put me into really, really, really busy work environments. Exceptionally busy work environments and where I had to work with other people, and I had to work with coworkers, but I had to work with customers at the same time as I'm working with coworkers. And you just need to make the shift of going out of the reactionary aspect of your ego. So if you have coworkers that are sabotaging you, what they're looking for really is a reaction. They're looking for reactions. It's like, okay, all right, you know, we got them, you know, let's see what they do. You know, so they're waiting for the reaction. If you don't give them a reaction, then it doesn't really feed their interest. And so the less reaction you give for sabotaging coworkers, the less sabotage you're going to experience. Okay? So look at how you're responding, and look how you're feeling. And even though you're not showing your feelings, they can feel your feelings because you have Kundalini and they'll feel that coming through your radiance. Okay, the radiance kind of gives you away. And so you want to really do your best to truthfully not be interested in how they're digging at your ego to react with you. Okay? How they're treating you. Are they treating you fairly? Are they manipulating you because you're a certain gender, you know, a man working in the lingerie department? Are they like, you know, messing with you that way? A woman working in a laboratory environment, are they messing with you that way? And, you know, these different things need to be dealt with through control and forgiveness and tolerance and patience and trust in your Kundalini. You've got to trust that she's given you this job. She's put you in this position in order to achieve specific lessons pertaining to how you live in society. At the same time, you're being transformed by the Kundalini, which means that your emotional reactions will be off the charts at times, which means that that you're going to have to suffer at the hands of these little petty tyrants. These little petty tyrants whose sole purpose it is, really, is to give you grief. Is to give you grief, okay? Don't let them have that satisfaction. Take the higher road. Do not respond with your ego. Do not respond with your passionate defense of how you deserve to be treated equally and fairly, just like anybody else on the workforce. Just accept that that is a fact, and that your Kundalini knows that that is a fact, and that you are there to learn how to swim your way through negative people. You know, the environment is full of negative people. I don't care where you're working. You can be homeless, and you know, the group of people are going to come up and they're going to demand ransom from you for them not to brutalize you in some way. Not take that last 25 cents that you might have. It's like, you know, well, you have to pay the toll. You know, I mean, there's negativity all over this world. It's a very predatorial world. And if you're having people, you know, come at you at work, then it is a lesson to be learned, not a situation to involve yourself in, unless you need to learn through that involvement. And if you have been learning and you're asking this question, well, then you know that you can basically step out of the reactionary and go right into the divine aspect. Do your job really well, excel at it, and there is no sabotage that can hurt a person that isn't responding. It's like, you know, somebody calls you a rapscallion. It's like, you're a rapscallion. You're a rapscallion. I know people are going, what the heck's that? But I've tried to use a term that's, like, you know, somewhat neutral. You're a rapscallion. And you just kind of like, oh, yeah, you're right. I am a rapscallion. Well, now what? Now what? It's like, well, he just admitted he's a rapscallion. Now what? Oh, geez, Louise. Well, we got to go at another angle. So they'll go at another angle and just say, okay, whatever you think. Have a nice day. Do your work. Do your work. Do it well. And pretty soon the badgering will stop. And if it doesn't stop, maybe it's time to get another job. Thanks for asking the question. All right, and we say, Tomei asks, she says, is it possible that the world is not overpopulated? Rather, it's necessary to bring all actors to the stage at once. Like, are we or will we be all here at once? No. I mean, nothing is impossible, so I will never say that, oh my gosh, you know, that's impossible. Because, you know, everything is possible with Kundalini. However, possibility and probability are two different things. And so, if you're talking about all actors at the stage at one time, well, there is God has particulated itself, himself, herself, into an infinitude of consciousness. And so, is your question pertaining to having all of God's consciousness particulate itself into a human body and reside on the world at the same time? No. I mean, the world isn't big enough for that. So I'm just suggesting that maybe you might want to broaden how you see all the actors. Okay. Because all the actors are constantly increasing. They're constantly increasing. And they're making babies like you wouldn't believe. I mean, even though the birth rate's gone down in the United States, it hasn't gone down in other places. Okay. And so, I think that we're literally overpopulated. And within the current technological standards, that overpopulation is causing a global warming event. And, you know, look at the Arctic, you know, look at the polar caps on both ends, the southern pole and the northern pole. I mean, things are really, really changing. Greenland is turning into a huge earth soil-based country because it's melting off at record levels. So, yeah, we need to back off of the birth rate. You know, we don't need to use abortion as a contraceptive, but we need to use other means as a form of contraceptive that can definitely allow people to do that wild thing, but also not to have the children that wild thing typically will bring about. So, you know, all the actors, I don't know. Let's see, and Brian asks, why is it that one can have a full-on awakening, and now we're assuming they understand what a full-on awakening is, full-on awakening, completely get the whole thing, so there's a red flag there, see the divine everywhere for days, and then revert back to normal as the Kundalini drops out of the head again? Well, you're not going to completely get the whole thing while you're in a body. Number one. So you're not going to completely get it. Your ego may think that it completely gets it, but the ego comes, or the Kundalini comes in and out like a tidal force. When the tide comes in, you have a lot of energy, you have a lot of wisdom, you have a lot of phenomena. Your ego may even think, yeah, I know everything. You know, I totally get it. I'm full on awakened. Then the tide goes out. And your ego's thinking, well, what happened? Where'd it go? Why did the Kundalini leave me? Well, it hasn't left you. The tide's just gone out. Gives you time to process what's already been given. And irrevocably, the tide will come back in. Ishta, honey, stop doing that. That's Ishta, my little dog. Thank you, dear. And the tide will come back in, and you'll have it again. And then it goes back out, then it comes back in, out, in, out, in, out, in. And that is how it works. That is how it works, because we cannot take it all at once. We don't get to have the full-on experience while we're in a body. Okay. So I hope that helped with that question there. And then I have another question here. Okay, well, I think... So some of the questions are about, like, when are you going live? Okay, so here we go. Let's see. And so I don't suppose that, that you have any questions right now. So I'm going to go into some of these questions. Some of you may know of John of God. John of God is a healer in Brazil. That is Ishta. Go in the other room, please, baby. Yeah, you're coming in here making all this noise. Go in there, please. Thank you. John of God is a healer in Brazil, and he's been accused of various interactions with people that have upset some of these people, and so he's been put in jail. And there is this big thing called a Me Too movement. And the Me Too movement is a forecasting of what is to come in the near future, like say within 10, 15 years. That forecasting is for a greater level of equality between men and women, you know, with the pay, with how people are recognized in society. There will be a greater level of equality between the male and the female on this world as a reflection of the equality between Shakti and Shiva. Sacred feminine and sacred male are 50-50. No one gender is not more important or better or closer to God or anybody else. Not at all. Not even close. Okay? It's all a 50-50 deal. Okay? However, the Me Too movements that are in process with John of God at this point are cashing in on revenge. They are using their choice to be with this man, to be seen with the great healer John of God, to be the woman that is with John of God, this great heroic figure of a healer. And oh my God, the women are just, I just gotta be with that man. He's just so powerful and so handsome, and he has control of so many other people. I just gotta be with him. I was down there. And that is exactly how the women who were with him were acting. Even the American mediums wanted to come down. They wanted to be with him. They wanted to be a medium of the Casa de Don Ignacio de Loyola. I'm so psychic. I'm just like so spiritual. I'm just like so absolutely with it. There, I am there. I just want it. John of God needs me. Needs me to be there. Oh my God, I'm so psychic. I'm so wonderful. You know, he needs me to make love with him, you know. And what has happened is they have twisted that, because I observed this full on. I watched this occur, okay. And now they have twisted it around, and they have used it because they didn't get the enlightenment. They didn't get to marry him. They didn't get to bear his children. They didn't get to do these things that they wanted to do. And so he all of a sudden becomes an abusive person, abusing hundreds of poor, unsuspecting women, which is just not the case. But now the guy languishes in prison because people have decided to commit revenge, to ride the coattails, to ride the whirlwind of that Me Too movement. And I'm going to suggest that is sowing the seeds of despair, my friends. Sowing the seeds of despair. People need to take personal responsibility for their choices. The Kundalini will not allow you to not take personal responsibility for your choices. And you will reap the rewards of castigating and imprisoning a person for your unethical lack of observation and respect for the choices that you've made in interacting with that individual. This happens all over the world, too. It's not just John of God. There's other people that have been accused of this or that, you know, sexually or just whatever it is. And, you know, the people wanted to become part of that because they thought that they were going to get some sort of great power or great Shaktipat or great level of healing like with John of God. They just wanted to be associated with that for the egocentrism involved in it. To be able to say, yes, I am the lover of this great person here. And yes, you can bow and scrape before me. It's okay. I'll be okay with that. Don't believe it. Don't believe what you read in the media about John of God and these women. I went down there. I had personal experience with John of God. Just a normal person. Smoked cigarettes. I always thought he smoked too much. But whatever. But, you know, he helped a lot of people. And the people that have put him in prison because they want to come forward as being poor, abused little girls, you know, they're going to reap that reward for cashing in on their revenge. Because they didn't receive the healing or the power or the position or whatever it was. Now, I'm not saying he's innocent of all things. I'm certainly not saying that. But I am saying that there was a great, great factor of people, women in general, and men, who wanted to be near and dearest to him so that they could be seen as being near and dearest to him and so that people could come up to them and you know, they would receive that adulation. You know, this happens in all great organizations that are doing good works. You know, people want to be associated with the leader in some way so that, you know, they can ride those coattails. And for those that are putting John of God in prison, instead of allowing him to do the good work that he's been doing for decades, you know, they will reap that reward. And the same thing with any of the other people, you know, these teachers in the world are being castigated at this time because of the Me Too movement and the revenge that people want to initiate upon on those who they feel have been unethical in their interrelationships with other people. They will also reap that reward. And for those of you that have had this happen to you, I just say keep doing your good work. Don't go into negativity. Don't go into hurtful response or reaction. Be tolerant. Be patient. Continue your good works. No matter what is said about you, just see it as an ego test. That's what I do. And keep giving your best to help those people along their path. All right. So there's that. Now, let's see, I don't see any other questions here. Let me do a double check. Da, 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 da. Yeah, okay. And there's a comment. So let's see. Well, David is asking a question, one of our admins. While thinking of death and its teachings recently, it came to me to celebrate calamity. So celebrate the disaster and rejoice in death. Deep explanation felt like it is a teaching, even hardest and most heartbreaking, one has had great purpose and value. Well, you can celebrate death. You can celebrate that. It's nothing to, I wouldn't necessarily worship it or anything, but the passing of a person who has lived a good life, helped a lot of people, like John of God, as I was just talking about John of God. You know, he's probably going to die in prison. but I will celebrate his death, because I also celebrate his life. I will celebrate the entire equation that is John of God, João Teixeira de Faria. Okay, I will celebrate him and the good work that he has done. And yes, of course, you know, along with the good work, we all do bad things in life. We all make mistakes. Okay, I'm certainly not taking away his capacity for making a mistake. But I think the goodness that a person does outweighs the mistakes that they make. Just, you got to look at, you have to look at who we look up to in life. If you're a Catholic person, Christian Catholic person, you look up to the saints. You look at, you know, St. Teresa of Avila, you look at St. John, you look at St. Augustine. St. Augustine was literally a mass murderer. Yeah, he was a mass murderer. He killed around 500 people. He loved it. He ran people through with a sword. You know, anybody who disagreed with his belief system on Christ was basically going to die. And yet, his kundalini activated. And he was able to live an exalted life. He received a level of redemption that allowed him to join in the union with divinity. Okay. And the same goes for you know, some of these Buddhist saints. Somebody asked me to look into a Buddhist saint called Marenti or someone like that. Sorry if I don't remember the name correctly. And this guy started out killing people with sorcery, using an exalted skill to kill people with. Once again, another mass murderer, another person that we would put to death in our society. But once again, he was redeemed. He was redeemed and you know, did really, you know, a lot of good things. So redemption does occur. Celebrate the entire equation of the individual, the life and the death. Celebrate the individual equation, the birth and the death and everything that happened in between. I hope that helps, David. And let's see here. Now I'm going to go on over here. I don't quite know how to do this with the computer, but Rija asks about platinum. And, you know, I've never come into enough platinum metal to put it against my skin. And if I did, the first thing I would do is cash it in for whatever cash value. So I can't tell you about platinum, although it's a good question. Right now, I would suggest you stick with copper, silver, and gold. Okay, let's see if there are any other questions here that I've missed. Okay. Some of the symptoms that you're going to have with kundalini is a lower back pain. I may have talked about this before, but it bears repetition because a lot of people get this. You're going to have a sore lower back, you know, where the spine passes through the pelvic girdle, you know, between the hips. You're going to have that sore back. And if you're riding motorcycles or you're a truck driver or you're doing anything that causes a sympathetic vibration to occur through the pelvic girdle into those lower the spinal cord areas, you're going to have pain. You're going to have pain. And Donnie, I don't know if there's another name in the Hindu scripture for spinal sweep. I don't know. I don't know that. Probably self-realization. But if you have the lower back pain and you're suffering from that, I will suggest that you do some forward bends with yoga. Go into the fetal position and I don't know what it's called, but if you wrap your arms around your legs and you kind of let yourself roll back on the spine and you roll up to the shoulders and you roll back onto your feet, you know, in still in the fetal position, this massages the spinal column. And as you massage the spinal column, you can relieve some of that lower back pain. But with Kundalini, you're going to also have expansion pains. And those expansion pains are going to radiate throughout the pelvic girdle and throughout the lower spine. And so these are things that you just really need to be okay with. Understand, nothing is wrong. This is normal. Okay, you don't need to take ibuprofen for it. You just let it occur. Keep yourself well hydrated. Keep your electrolytes healthy. Have the watermelon. Don't let your adrenal system, flare up and bring you into a fearful state. Let's see. Yeah. So there is that. And it looks like that is about that. So I hope the sound is okay with this one. I'm kind of banking on it since I'm in the same place I was last time. So go with that. Let me see. I'm going to look through here, see if anybody has a... for those of you... Johnny's asking, is it normal that now I alternate sacred female movements and sacred masculine movements randomly? Johnny, if your Kundalini is compelling you to do that, then it is normal. It is the right thing to do, definitely. Okay, and talked about that. Lindsay asks, is Kundalini part of the soul or body, and can Kundalini die? Kundalini cannot die. Never dies. Kundalini is divine. It is a divine expression. It is the hand of God upon you. And it does not ever die, and it doesn't ever weaken either. It engraves itself into the soul. Once the Kundalini is up, it engraves itself into the soul so that the very next body or series of bodies that the soul takes upon this world or other worlds, the Kundalini is there. The Kundalini is there. And as I described in some of my writings last night, yesterday, on the Kundalini Awakening exclamation group on Facebook, I came into this world with an inscribed soul by Kundalini, which doesn't mean that, you're fully awakened. It just means that you have the phenomena that came with you from the last time that you were awakened to the Kundalini. That if you take a new body, that new body is going to have to reactivate and reawaken. You'll still have phenomena. You'll still have many of the great gifts without the awakening. But the body itself requires an activation and an awakening of that Kundalini in that body, within the genetic line of that parentage that you have just incarnated into. Okay, so you'll need to go through the activation and the awakening and all of the different things. Because part of the reason is because we come in here with legitimate forgetfulness. We are placed under the veil. And the Kundalini is a process where the veil is slowly taken away. And eventually, slowly, not just like ripped off, of your eyes, but, slowly, eventually, you acclimate away from the veil. And you're able to see the truth as it is, rather than as society tries to make you think it is. So there's that. So Kundalini is a divine manifestation that becomes part of the soul and of the body, and it will never, ever die. Ever. Thank you. It's a good question, Lindsay. So I'm pulling it up here. I'm on the phone. The reason why I'm doing it with the phone here is because it seems that the sound comes through better. Let's see. Somebody is saying... Bucheb is asking, is isolation useful to Kundalini? I feel the desire to change. Isolation is actually good for the Kundalini. There's a reason why a lot of these Tibetan monks walled themselves into a cave and had food, slid under a, you know, a tiny little aperture in the wall, and that's where they were there for years. It is good. It is good. Isolation is good, but also going into society is also good. It's hard sometimes to go into society because you become so sensitive to the vibrations and the thoughts and the feelings. You know, all of these equate to vibration. Thought is a vibration. Feelings are vibrations. And you come into these vibrations and it can feel like you're being machine-gunned with with other people's vibrations. And so sometimes that's hard. But it's good also because it allows you to expand your radiance into the lives of others. You're not an island. Kundalini didn't come to you so that you could spend your time in a cave. Okay? Sometimes you want to spend some time in a cave just to be with yourself and with your Kundalini and to nurture it from a level of silence and a level of introspection. But that isn't the whole cookie. The other part of the cookie is going out there into the populations and learning to rise above the harsh negative vibratory environment that populations typically have. Okay. You are a light unto this world. But if nobody sees the light, what are you? Right? Okay. All right. Thank you, Abuche. That's a very good question. Let's see. So, I don't see any other questions here. And so I'd just like to say thank you, everyone, for watching. And if you have any other questions, I'll be doing maybe one more. If I get enough questions, I'll do one more live video. And David, please upload this to our YouTube channel. We have a YouTube channel here, and I think David will give you the name of that and how to get over to that in case you want to see these in the future. And sometimes it's a real good idea to revisit these videos. Thank you, everyone, for watching. Have a blessed day and a blessed life.